Dr. Kulasinghe, President. Mr. President-elect, committee members of the Civil Engineering Sectional Committee of the Institute of Engineers of Sri Lanka, family members of the late Dr. Kulasinghe, distinguished guests. Quite apart from the singular privilege of being invited to deliver the memorial lecture of such an illustrious son of Sri Lanka, there was also personal motivation for me to readily accept this honor. First, I was requested by Dr. Kulasinghe's son Harry, Harith, my friend and fellow oil field veteran. Second, Dr. Kulasinghe was a colleague and friend of my grandfather, Edwin Pereira. In two institutes, they served together. And lastly, we both had occasion to head the same institution, a generation apart. He, the Port Commission, and me, the Sri Lanka Ports Authority. And in memory of that bond, I've taken the liberty of wearing our alma mater tie. For all these reasons, I'm delighted to be here tonight. I would like, before we start the lecture, to clarify what the title means, because I had some discussions before about what monetization of reserves meant. Well, what it simply means is converting resources into cash. It means taking a resource from where it is and converting it into liquid cash. That's all it means. You will hear some of the challenges that we face in doing that in our situation, and you will hear some of the challenges that Sri Lanka faces on the road to becoming a petroleum nation. Let me start with the story of what happened last year in October. On the 2nd of October, the oil company you may have heard of, Cairn, in their very first exploration well off the west coast of Sri Lanka, drilled into a 25-meter thick column of gas and condensate. This column was sitting 3.5 kilometers below the surface of the sea in a water depth of about 1.3 kilometers. Contained a pressure, a gas pressure of 4,500 psi, and spread over an extent of approximately 10 square kilometers. That volumetric, simple, deterministic calculation reveals approximately, with a 22% rock porosity, a few hundred billion standard cubic feet of gas and condensate in place. This discovery was Sri Lanka's first ever positive indication of hydrocarbon accumulation offshore. There had been some stories in the past. This was the first positive indication. 6 weeks later, the same team from Cairn, the exploration team, called us and asked us for permission to drill an extra 1 kilometer deep to extend the depth of the second well by another 1 kilometer. We said, of course, what are you looking for? We've encountered some basalt, which is a volcanic outflow, and we believe that below the basalt, there will be more sedimentary sequences. They did. They drilled through 700 meters of basalt, which is a very hostile environment to drill in, to drill through. And they broke through the bottom and drilled into 200 more meters of soft sedimentary formation. At this point, they terminated the well because by this time it was 4.7 kilometers deep and on the borderline of the specifications of that operation. But interestingly, inside the basalt, in between the different layers of the basalt, they found 24 meters of vertical thickness of what we in the industry call pay, which is the same or similar composition, gas and condensate. Now, in the first well, it was easy for us to estimate the size of the reservoir because it was a bright spot on the seismic. It was clear to see and clear to interpret. In the second well, it was not so easy. The second well, because of the volcanic outflow over the gas, the seismic signal was masked. So to date, we don't know how large the extent of the reservoir is in the Barracuda well. We think it could be bigger than that of the Dorado. Now these two wells, they existed 38 kilometers apart. And as such, the geological correlation from one to the other was somewhat speculative because we don't have too much geological data on the Manar Basin. Therefore, when the two samples of gas from each of these wells was analyzed and found to be different in chemical composition, we found that quite interesting. Because what that means is that the origin of these two reservoirs is different. So that of course means to us that there are multiple systems, multiple petroleum systems, potentially present in the Manar Basin. Good news. But qualified, tempered with the fact that the Manar Basin is in fact a fairly hostile environment. If that much gas had been found next door, for example, we would find that very good news. We would be able to derive economic benefit fairly rapidly because onshore gas production is a fairly straightforward, in most cases, engineering challenge. The engineering challenge facing bringing offshore subsea, subsurface gas to the surface and then to land is quite different. There is potentially more than 1 trillion cubic feet of gas, 1 TCF in oil spill speak, in just that block, in just the two reservoirs penetrated by the two wells. There are several more blocks as well. However, the question of producibility exists. The gas is there in place. In order for us to take any advantage of it or make any economic use of it, we need to prove to the industry, to the accounting standards of this world, to the professional community, that this gas is actually producible. In order to prove that this gas is producible, which means in order to monetize this gas, there are a significant number of challenges. And I'd like to share with you a few of those today. The third well that Cairn drilled didn't encounter any hydrocarbon at all. It was drilled in close proximity to the first one, 4 kilometers, and it revealed what the industry calls it was a dry hole. It just encountered water. But that isn't bad news, because in the information that well gave us about that structure, it helped to explain why there perhaps wasn't any hydrocarbon there. So the next well that Cairn drills will be in a slightly different place, chasing a different target. So it was a useful well. It didn't reveal hydrocarbon, but it was a useful well, geologically speaking. So getting back to the topic of monetizing or converting reserves into cash, over the years, in the maturity of the oil industry and the gas industry, several professional bodies worldwide have created classification systems. In fact, reserves classification is a very important and hotly debated topic. As an aside, many of you have heard of OPEC. OPEC was a consortium of countries, resource-holding countries, formed in 1960 for the purpose of regulating the price of oil, because their economies depended on it. And eventually the organization grew to 13 member states and came to the agreement that between them they would quota their production based on their stated reserves. So you can imagine what an interesting challenge that was. If a country in OPEC wished to produce more for budgetary reasons, it would need to restate its reserves. And they did, regularly. Eventually, some order crept into the process, and we now have several systems that are acknowledged worldwide to be of industry standard. Most notably from the Society of Petroleum Engineers and the American Association of Petroleum Geologists, that have found their way into formal oil and gas accounting practice and regulation. So what I'm saying here is, having oil and gas is one thing. Being able to establish a classification for that oil and gas is quite a different thing. Without classification, the oil and gas may well as not exist. It is classification that gives reality to the reserves. In simple terms, the classification tells the rest of the world, which include all the stakeholders, operators, investors, partners, other institutions, gives them an indication of the confidence with which those reserves can be produced. Remember that these reserves are somewhere far away. Unfortunately for us, our reserves happen to be sitting in 2 or 3 kilometers below the surface, below the seabed, in a water depth of almost the same. Which is, ladies and gentlemen, which is pretty much as hostile as the environment in the Gulf of Mexico, the deep water Gulf of Mexico, the Gulf of Guinea, and offshore deep water Brazil under the salt. It's deep, it's expensive, and it requires a lot of expertise and experience in similar conditions to exploit successfully. This realization, of course, was a little sobering because it put us in the big league when it came to lifting cost. Lifting cost is an oil field term which describes the cost of bringing oil and gas from in situ where it is to the surface. And in the Gulf of Mexico, for example, lifting cost is approximately 20 times what it is in, for example, Iraq or Saudi Arabia on land. So we are talking about a significant cost. Just to give you an idea of magnitude, $50 per barrel is what it costs to bring Gulf of Mexico oil to just the surface in the deepest parts. So in that case, if oil dips below 50%, economics speak for themselves. So therefore, we have to ask ourselves now in planning our future, of course, we have a lot more exploration to do. There are many more blocks that will be awarded later on in this year. We are hoping to see a significant increase in activity offshore, in exploration activity. All of this aimed towards increasing our potential reserves. Even if, however, we find enough volume present, possibly in just these two, but perhaps we need to aggregate a few more to it, a few more reservoirs, to justify the enormous expense of subsea completions, very complex subsea completions, and the additional expense and technology of what the industry calls flow assurance. There are several other questions to ask. But before that, I would like to explain to you what flow assurance means. It seems like an obvious thing. If there is high pressure somewhere, you lower a pipe into it, release the pressure, bring the produce somewhere else. The problem happens, of course, when this pressure exists in gas, which is subsea, and the bottom of the deep subsea is near freezing temperature. What happens when gas passes through that channel is that hydrates tend to form and clog up the flow lines. So can you imagine spending $1 billion inserting flow lines and pumps and aggregate systems and then having them block up 1.5 kilometers below the surface? So flow assurance has become a very, very high focus, high dollar area in the oil and gas industry, particularly in deep water. We're back to the other questions we need to ask ourselves before we can talk about monetizing those gas reserves. Having them is nice. But the questions we need to ask ourselves are, do we have offtake infrastructure? Do we have a distribution network for this gas? Do we have a market for it? Domestic? International? Do we have a plan for it? Is there national policy? Have we got the appropriate resource taxing regime? Have we got the appropriate resource allocation, revenue allocation regime in place? These are questions that we are not asking ourselves. These are questions that the industry who will classify us will ask us. Those questions come back to the first question, which is, do we have enough oil and gas? Do we have oil and gas? So unless we can answer yes to that, we can't answer yes to the we have. We can't answer yes to the we have unless we have that. So it is a little bit of a circle here. So therefore, we can't call ourselves credibly petroleum new rich until we have in place all the essential combinations of technology, market, and government rule. All of that comes into the equation when investment in this sector will be contemplated by outsiders. So therefore, we can't just go to the bank. This situation requires us to look closely at what exactly we need to do in Sri Lanka to attract the kind of partners who are able to impart the technology, the experience, and the funding, the resourcing, to allow these assets to be produced. I shall share a few of those ideas with you as we go along. Before we get onto the economic side, I feel I should share with you just 5 minutes worth of technical description here on why those reserves are where they are and do we have any more anywhere else. These are common questions we get asked of the PRGS. In answering that question, I will stick to one theory in particular. There are two competing theories of oil and gas origin in this world. One theory states that oil and gas is a product of cooling primeval substances in the mantle of the earth, percolating up through the crust, accumulating in fissures and faults and folds, and finding their way into reservoirs. It's an abiogenic origin theory where organic matter is not involved. And it is very compelling. There are some very, very interesting reasons to listen to such a theory, including the fact that hydrocarbons are found on other planets. However, the currently accepted theory is that petroleum results as a particular kind of decomposition of organic matter under certain conditions, and that decomposition yields certain types of petroleum which migrates through the earth because petroleum is lighter than the water, which is in which the earth is saturated, rises to the top. Where it comes out to surface, it oxidizes and vanishes. Where it stops, gets trapped, it accumulates. So using that model, and I think Dr. Kulasinghe mentioned, I was a physicist, and physicists like to use models that fit the observations and evidence best. And at the moment, that's enough for us. That tells us everything we need to know about the petroleum system in Manna. If we use that observation, we need to take a closer look at what we actually have out there in the Manna Basin. So there is in your hands a handout. If I may ask you to look at the first page of that handout, it's called Attachment 1. If there are any geoscientists present here today, I apologize in advance for my simple treatment of their fantastic subject and for any mistakes I made. But you will see that right at the very bottom is a long, long time ago, 4.5 billion years ago. In fact, you will also see next to that a statement that says that Sri Lanka's crustal rock comes from those ages. And that's true. It tells you that Sri Lanka, the rock that we stand on, the rock that we're building our buildings on, the rock that you engineers drive your piles into, is the oldest on the planet. And it's also quite close to surface. So how did it get there? A long, long time ago, as the earth evolved and cooled and eroded and sedimented and buried deeper, this rock was actually submerged. And it was very heavy in minerals, because at that time, 4.5 billion years ago, there was no life as we know it. There was no organic matter. So everything that is in our rock is mineral rich. There were lots of minerals. This mineral-rich stuff got buried deep, got baked, got cooked in certain conditions of temperature, pressure, and chemical environment. And over the years, about 300 million years ago, started to come back up to the surface because tectonic plates were moving, and it was being upthrust. The Himalayas were formed at about the same time as Sri Lanka was formed from this rock. Now, this ancient rock, 4 billion years ago, has suddenly found itself at the surface again. And it has evolved, it has eroded again. And it is the erosion of this rock with its rich, rich mineral content that have given us these millions and millions of fabulous gems that Sri Lanka is famous for. These gems that flowed into the rivers and the floodplains of ancient Sri Lanka. We're finding them now. But anyway, the interesting thing is, what it tells you is that most of Sri Lanka, if we are going by the biogenic theory, which is sedimentation, organic, inorganic decomposition of organic matter, migration, most of land Sri Lanka does not have a thick cover of sediment. It's all Precambrian metamorphic rock. And the amount of hydrocarbon in such formations is extremely small, if at all. So this, of course, means that we need to start thinking about really looking offshore for our resources. There are a few areas which are not in the same category, such as the west coast, the northwest coast, the peninsula of Jaffna, and Tabo area in the Putlam district. There is some deeper sediment. There, that sediment warrants exploration, prospecting for hydrocarbon accumulation. But the bottom line is, most of what we think we have is offshore. Now, offshore where? On the north side, Cauvery Basin is a shallow basin, and it's fairly young, geologically speaking. You will see that on the top of that picture, the Cauvery sediments are very young. They're the youngest. The Manna Basin is west of us, and those sediments are a little bit older, but They're still young, geologically. On the east coast, we have a very steeply declining continental shelf, which meets an abrupt margin with the abyssal plain at a very, very significant water depth, around 4 kilometers. So while that area is very, very full of promise because it is the Bay of Bengal fan, we don't see that as bringing much potential to us economically in the near future because it's on the border of technology. Ultimately, what I really want to say here is that we're looking at offshore operations for Sri Lanka, for potential Sri Lankan petroleum wealth. Offshore operations are significantly more complex than land-based drilling. Our strategies and policies must take into account in the future that we do not, at this point in time as a country, have the requisite expertise, experience, or financing to undertake such ventures alone. However, there are partners, possible partners in this world, if the conditions here are appropriate in terms of their risk profile, who may consider coming, investing in Sri Lanka, partnering with the government to explore, prospect, and produce oil. My point in all of this is, until such time as we can stand on our own 2 feet financially in terms of the oil industry, we do need to look to the right path. Then we can call ourselves resource holders. Because remember, unless there is a plan to produce, the economics are right, the technology is there, we can't even declare them as reserves. They are just there. Let's move on to reserves now, which is attachment 2. If you may bear with me and move to attachment 2. The best way to look at this is if you consider that whole square, that ovalized square, as all the petroleum reserves in the world. Everything we have. Known, unknown, discovered, undiscovered. And you will see that if you look along the vertical column on the left, there is a discovered petroleum in place section and an undiscovered petroleum in place section. The relative sizes are not correct. This is just a graphic. Now if you look at the discovered petroleum in place, you will see that that is divided itself into two, commercial and sub-commercial. And then when you move horizontally, you will see that the reserves themselves and the contingent resources below them and the prospective resources below them, right at the bottom, all divided into three columns. 1P, 2P, 3P, or 1C, 2C, 3C. I think we need to take a quick look at this so that you will share with me an idea of the challenge we face. Let me start by saying that the only classification that the Securities and Exchange Council in the United States allows of companies that are oil companies, the only classification it recognizes for them to be able to fill their statement of reserve, their declaration of reserves declaration, to book their reserves, is 1P. So that's just a little small square of that huge chunk. The part that says 1P, that's the only thing they recognize. Which means that it is commercial as a start. What does it mean by commercial? Commercial means the technology must be current in the market. The market conditions must be supportive. If the oil price drops below the cost of lifting, for example, it's no longer commercial. And last but not least, the government regulations must not push it into non-commerciality. they must also be supportive of that. Just to give you an example, if the price of oil today is $100 and the cost of lifting it to the surface is 70, that leaves a 30% profit. It looks commercial. But if the government taxation is 30%, then it is not commercial. Or, being the government taxation doesn't change very much, it stays 30%, the price of oil goes down to 90, it's suddenly not commercial again. If the price of oil goes to 110, it suddenly becomes commercial again. What I'm saying here is, whatever number that exists today for any oil company or country does not have to exist tomorrow. It's a dynamic, moving target. And it moves with the cost of technology, the cost of the market price, the market conditions, and of course, the fiscal regime. Now, in Sri Lanka, we don't control the technology. We are not in the driving seat of cutting-edge oil and gas technology. We cannot control the market because we are definitely a buyer in the market. The only thing we can play with in those three important parts is the fiscal regime, is the government rules. That is why it is so important for us to get that equation right. So what does 1P, 2P, 3P mean exactly? Well, what it means, they're also given different names. 1P is called, and I'm sorry it is not visible there for some reason, but 1P is called proven reserves, 1P. That's that little square. Then 2P is called probable. And 3P is called possible. And what separates them? Probability. 1P, that quantity, there is a 90% probability that those reserves will find their way to surface under current conditions. 2P, there is a 50% probability that 1P plus 2P can be brought to surface. In other words, probable plus proven at current market conditions. And 3P, it simply means that there is a 10% probability that proven plus probable plus possible can all be produced under current market conditions. 10% probability. So, which do you think is the larger one? I'll answer it for you. It's possible. 1P is the smallest. It's the most conservative. It's the most, shall we say, it's the most conservative. Then we move down to contingent. Contingent, and again, I don't mean to subject you to too much rigor here, but I don't think we'll go into the prospective. Let's stop at contingent. But it's important to look at contingent because the boundary between contingent and reserves is always shifting. Contingent means any one of those three things that we talked about, which is the technology, the market conditions, and the government rules, any one of them can change at any time. If they change to the negative, some of the reserves will move into contingent resources. If they change to the positive, more beneficial, some of the contingent resources become reserves. So there is a vertical migration between those two, which is important for us to understand. And it happens at every probability. When, for example, Cairn gave us their estimate of reservoir size, they gave us three numbers. They said, the 1P is X 100 million barrels. The 2P is Y 100 million barrels, not barrels, standard cubic feet, gas. And 3P is so much. That's the way oil companies speak. The only number, and of course the 3P number is much bigger, because it's the one with the loosest probability, the highest, shall we say, the least restriction, the most optimistic. Wherever you're an oil company or a country, what you can take to the bank is the 1B number, which is the smallest number. So our objective is to maximize our potential 1B, is to maximize it by policy, maximize it by investing in technology, maximize it by doing what we can to impact the market. But it's a moving target. That's my main point. And if we don't have a classification associated with our reserves, they do not exist in the eyes of the world. There is a thing called unrecoverable. Just for your interest, all that means is that that particular segment or volume of oil cannot actually be economically recovered. It cannot be technically recovered because some characteristic or the other, like surface tension, holds it in place and it cannot be extracted. That exists. It's like you can't squeeze the water out of a sponge completely. Gas, just winding up on the reserves classification, gas has an additional challenge. These, I've shared with you the reason or the actual the reasoning behind these different classifications and what they are, how they relate to each other. In addition to that rigorous view, gas has two more requirements. If we want to say we have proved reserves of gas, just those three is not enough. We have to, additionally, we have to prove that the investor has taken what the oil industry calls an FID, final investment decision. That means they have taken the commercial plunge. They have made the commitment. Because gas reserves are not reserves if nobody has committed to produce them. So we may have all the gas in the world, but if nobody comes and commits to produce this gas, takes the decision, declares it, it doesn't exist. The second thing is that this is to put pressure on resource holders. The state must sign off on said project, in simple terms. The state must endorse the same project. In fact, I will paraphrase, I will quote from a text, a reference book. Quote, gas reserves only exist if the commercial viability only exists. They're talking about reserves existing. Now there is gas in the ground, everybody can see it, but the gas reserves only exist if the commercial viability of a given gas project is demonstrated by appropriate technical and economic studies and a decision for their development is taken or envisaged shortly. So, ladies and gentlemen, I have to share with you, we don't have any gas at the moment. But we have the potential to produce some in the future. Suppose, from the country's point, we need a master plan. And without that master plan, we can't monetize the reserves. But the reserves are there to be monetized. We need to find a little bit more. Let's take a look, we're through the bulk of it, but we have a very, very important thing to talk about now, is how do we share this resource? We have now looked at the resource where it is, we've looked at how the world views it, we've understood that in our case, we are a little bit unlucky in terms of where it is, which means we can't develop it organically, we have to go out. Now, being in a position of attracting investment to develop our resources, we need to look at how other countries do it and how resources are shared. Because ladies and gentlemen, unlike most other resource extraction projects, such as mining, gemming, or other things, in deep water, the difference between investment and return could be 20 years. In other words, you could spend $3 billion, invest a lot of money in pipe and valves and so on in the ground, and not see anything coming out of them for 10, 15 years. That requires a particular kind of hardness of heart and a clearness of mind. It's a risky business. Therefore, we need to provide some clear and tangible idea of reward. So resources have to be shared, and the interesting thing is, what's the objective of sharing resources? Is to make sure that there is a fair share to the owner, fair to the state, but at the same time, there is sufficient incentive in terms of profit for the investor to wish to invest and take that big risk. This is an eminently reasonable concept, very well accepted. The problem, of course, is reaching that balance, because people just don't seem to agree on the right balance. Who should get what share? That's why economics, politics, society, culture, environment, they all come into the picture. And in several countries, really have forced non-optimal policy out in the open. I'll give you an example. In the World Bank, a study was done in 2000, the year 2000, and it looked at OECD countries up in Europe. OECD countries have been finding and producing oil and gas for a long, long time. So if you were to consider what their underground resources would be, their monetizable reserves would be per square kilometer, you would not be surprised because they are very efficient at what they do, to learn that it was $125,000 per square kilometer was the subsurface wealth of the OECD countries. The World Bank study compared them with Africa. What do you think the African number was? Has Africa produced lots of oil and gas? No. Does it have lots of oil and gas? Absolutely. But the number of reserves was 25,000. So this is in a continent that is hardly explored, not produced, but yet has classified reserves of only $25,000 per square kilometer, whereas fields in Holland, Denmark, France, Germany have been bled dry, and they still have in place $125,000 per square kilometer. What's the difference? It's not that it isn't there. It hasn't been found. And that is because African countries, by inference, have not provided sufficient incentive to prospecting. If you don't prospect, you don't find. If you don't find, you can't explore, you can't quantify, you cannot monetize. The message here is most of these countries that were in this survey had very protectionist regimes, very onerous, very conservative investment regimes, which precluded companies, which essentially chased companies away. Now, there have been good reasons to take care. Many companies have taken advantage of a lax regime and gone in there, and they have understated the size of reserves, they have overstated the difficulty and cost of extraction, they have transfer priced and done all sorts of things to put value somewhere else. But I don't think it's something we should believe true of all companies, and certainly it's not something we should form national policy on. So from our point of view, it's the solution to that problem is well within the hands of those African governments, provided they can reach out and grab it. And when they do, and they open up, and exploration takes place, the prospecting takes place, then they will reap the benefits. The way through that situation, which we are looking at here in Sri Lanka, is to decouple the exploration or prospecting part from the production part. Prospecting is important for us. If we don't have people coming to Sri Lanka and prospect, we will never know better. We can't prospect for ourselves. So we must decouple the prospecting commitment with the exploration, with the production commitment. The UK has done just that. Right now we have an international consultant working for us that is working on such questions that we pose them. Let's now go to the attachment three. For those those of you interested, this is something to take home as a reference as to what are the current, now we've learned about the reserves and all of that and how they're classified and recognized, where they're found, and we've looked at the fact that we need to work in partnership. Now this is a document that tells us how different countries do it. So I will keep it very simple and very quick. The first regime is complete state ownership. That is where the state owns the whole resource, but has sufficient funds and experience to exploit said resource. The only country that has, well, that's the only, but one of the most successful country in doing this has been Saudi Arabia. And of course, before the fall of the Soviet Union, there was Russia, there was the Soviet Union as well. And I will leave you to read through the different systems. It is not very prevalent now, only Saudi Arabia. I think almost every other country in the world has other companies working in it. Then the rest of the world is divided into two, something called concessionary and contractual. And the difference is very simple. The difference is that in a concessional regime, you license somebody to exploit national reserves. In the UK, in the North Sea, if you have a production license, it entitles you to produce that oil and sell it on the market. The state simply licenses you and sits back. You take its oil, you produce it, and you sell it. How does the state make its income? Just like any other company, it taxes profits. So it's a standard developed world mechanism for taxing resource or for gathering resource rent. The company doesn't, the state doesn't own the oil, the state doesn't share in a part of it, the state simply lets the company do anything it wants to, looks at its books carefully and taxes the profit. As simple as that. If you go to the next page, there will be some countries that run that regime right now. Brazil, UK, Canada, USA, etc. You can see that these are countries that are developed countries in which the state intervention in the economy is minimal. The next regime, the other half of the rest of the world outside Saudi, is contractual. Contractual is where the state owns the reserves and retains ownership of reserves and contracts third parties to exploit them. If you've heard of something called a production sharing contract, well, that's part of the contractual regime. If you've heard of something called a service contract, it's part of the contractual regime. A service contract is something where if I'm the government, I pay a company money per barrel of oil it's produced, but the oil remains mine. If it's a production sharing, then the oil remains mine as a state. That company is entitled to a share of it after recovering its cost, but the title to that share is only transferred at the point of export. So as long as the oil is in country, it belongs to country. That company can take its share at the point of export. There you will see mostly developing countries and countries with an active state intervention in the economy. Sri Lanka is a contractual regime. We have a contractual regime. All the oil produced in Sri Lanka belongs to Sri Lanka. In the event that Cairn produces oil or gas, they will be entitled to a share of it. We will get our share. Their share will only be transferred to them at the point of export. Does that make sense? That's a contractual regime. So we're not alone. There's Indonesia, Bahrain, India, Sri Lanka, a whole bunch of countries. Many, 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 many countries run contractual regimes with production sharing contracts. It's a concept that started in 1916, Indonesia, or thereabouts, and has now become fairly commonplace. And the service contracts, as you can see in that graphic, they are part of the contractual regime. Sometimes there are things called risk service contracts, where the country does not pay anything at all. It simply says, company can come in, company can spend its money, company can do what it can do, and if oil and gas is produced, company will be paid per barrel. But they won't even pay for the prospecting or for the development or anything like that. And there are many countries that run contracts like that, mostly the Middle East, where reserves are not an issue. Mostly on land. It's very rare to find a deep water offshore contract which is a risk service contract. Then, on the back of it is a summary. Page 3 just gives you a summary. And I would like to draw your attention to what we have written here at the bottom. It is observed that no single best petroleum fiscal regime exists. Please be aware of that. A number of people have come to us and said, you should follow so-and-so's example, you should follow so-and-so's example. We thank them and we look at the example, but there is no simple example, no single example worldwide that we can cut and paste into Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is our own requirement, is our own socio-political economic requirement, and that needs to be captured by a custom-made fiscal regime. Last on the attachment, and we are very nearly at the end of the lecture, is attachment 4, which is simply a web link for those of you who are interested in picking up, downloading, or having resource to one of the best oil field glossaries. So it tells you the meaning of all the words in the industry. Very useful. At the moment, there's about 5,000 entries, and most of the common terms are there with very good explanations, and it's in multiple languages. So that brings me to almost the end. The last thing I want to share with you is what are we actually doing in Sri Lanka with all of this, with all of these challenges. Well, the first thing we're doing is strengthening ourselves institutionally. One of the biggest challenges that developing countries have faced in the rest of the world, ladies and gentlemen, and they are still facing it today, is what the industry calls asymmetry of information. It means the companies know more than we do. That is not a healthy situation in which to launch a new petroleum industry. Asymmetry of information can only be addressed one way, and that is by building the capacity we require in-house to understand our asset better. Asymmetry of information is what causes oil companies to push boundaries that in other industries they might not, because they might be able to get away with it because we wouldn't know any better. So asymmetry of information is addressed by institutional strengthening, and that means that we are right now investing in the very best hardware, software, training, exposure for our little team and those to soon join it, so that when the time comes to discuss, sit at the table with the big oil companies, we know what we're talking about when it comes to basin models, reservoir models, production profiles, and field development plans. In doing so, we are developing linkages with Sri Lankan expatriates, and there are several. We have one right here, who are in the oil industry, who are very experienced, who have the knowledge that we would like to have. We are forming a big roster with them and interchanging a lot of information and a lot of invitations and a lot of, shall we say, goodwill is being exchanged to strengthen over time Sri Lankans' capacity here. The second thing that we're doing is that we're building capacity in our business and academic circles. The Chambers of Commerce are actively involved with us in discussions on how to strengthen national participation, local content building into the oil and gas program. The University Grants Commission is planning a workshop with us, stakeholder workshop, to bring the key academics together to put together a petroleum training program, because you can't force somebody to hire from within Sri Lanka unless you can give them somebody to hire from We're looking aggressively at what economic model Sri Lanka needs to take. What should we tax? How much should we charge as royalty without jeopardizing that investment we need? We need to strike a balance between what is the national requirement and what is internationally acceptable as a level of risk. That can only be done with a detailed economic model into which we can plug any scenario of production, any scenario of expenditure. We can compare it with Myanmar, we can compare it with all these other different countries and assess the different state takes. Carrying that one further, we are benchmarking ourselves. One thing is for sure, there is a lot more opportunity in the oil and gas business, a lot more opportunity for investment than there is money. Which of course means that if we want to get the best investment into Sri Lanka, which is the best companies, then we need to be more competitive than the people they might otherwise go to. So we are benchmarking ourselves in two ways, legally and fiscally. We have drafted amendments to the Act to push the regulation to one side, policy to one side, and operations to one side. At the moment, they're all combined, and it's not very good for proper industry health when that happens. We are looking at legal systems in different places to see which one would be the lowest legal risk that we can adopt in Sri Lanka and present to our potential investors. We're looking at fiscal systems, fiscal regimes, and comparing ourselves with some of our neighbors, India, Myanmar, Bangladesh, but not also some of our non-neighbors, Israel, Mozambique, Tanzania, for different reasons. That benchmarking is absolutely vital for our competitive edge. If we do not benchmark and we go to the market blind, we don't know about our assets, we don't know about operations, we are not doing ourselves or yourself a service. Environment is important to us. It's actually critical to us. We in the PRDS take a very firm view on environmental protection. I won't talk too much about it now, but there is a very big initiative that is spreading right now. It's an environmental baseline study of that entire area. Every single government and many non-government stakeholders are involved who have experience